Hello, chess fans. Let's look today over a very interesting game between Ullmann and Geller, two very strong grandmasters. And Geller here is our hero with the black pieces, and that's why I rotated the board, and we can look at this very high-level game from the black side of view. Ullmann opened with 1d4, and now we get a King's Indian setup. I go over the first moves quickly. He plays with white bishop g5. It's called the Averbach variation. And Geller reacts with c5. And we can already see he looks for some queenside action. The bishop g5 is a move which wants to provoke this weakness on h6, and the bishop goes back. He wants to get a tempo with queen d2 now. The king simply protects this so-called weakness. It's not really a weakness, but it's a little softening the king side of black. And now we see after knight f3 already a very creative and sharp b5 pawn sacrifice for open files. White takes it in the end with the bishop, and now the queen comes out. Let's be prepared for the rooks. It's a tip for white. The rooks can appear on the B and or E files, A files, and win the pawn back, and still black has initiative. Now the bishop goes back and the queen comes in, and not only has an eye on this B2 pawn, but also attacks together with the knight on F6, the pawn on E4. That's why Ullmann already had problems to solve here. He decided to push this pawn forward. When in doubt, play active, he thinks, and now the knight is attacked. This knight now wants to exchange this annoying bishop. Already it's attacked two times. He moves it back, and now comes bishop a6. Interesting move. This exchange has two goals. First, black wants to weaken all these light squares with this exchange, and also come quickly with the other pieces to the queen side here. And this is a good exchange with full swing. He takes it. Now this rook also defends d6 and is prepared to double up on, for instance, the a file. White takes, no problem. Black takes back, and now finally white castles. Let's develop the last minor piece. And Geller is ready now to swing over with the f8 rook, and he can do more damage on the queen side as planned. Now rook ae1, interesting. This rook was a little bit in the scope of this g7 bishop, that's why he moved it, and he also confesses that he can't defend his pawns on the queen side. He will at least lose one pawn back, and Geller finally takes this bishop on g3. This bishop wasn't running away, that's why he could afford to take it late. Now the knight comes in, and we already see the weakness of the light squares and a new good square for this knight. Rook e2, and the knight jumps in. Now the queen is threatened, queen d3. The other rook comes, and this is now already a problem. If he moves, for instance, a3, this knight could take a3, and if he takes back, this knight is unprotected. So it's not possible to defend here, and that's why he moved instead b3. And now we have a transaction to the endgame. Queen takes knight, queen takes, bishop takes back, and now he wins the knight back. But the a2 pawn falls. We have equal material now. Remember, black, in this case, yellow, sacrificed a pawn. It was a positional sacrifice. And now all the hopes of Ullmann lie in the endgame. He offered now a draw, he attacks the bishop, but Geller said, no, I move this bishop back. This bishop on f6 instead of g7 controls the knight on f3 a little bit, and this is a position black only can win or draw, he cannot lose it. His bishop is better, and his rook is better. And let's see how he makes progress here. King f1, this is a little bit of a mistake. He should have moved here his g-pawn, because now Geller moved his pawns without problems forward. And Ullmann will regret this little mistake later. King f1, it looks like Ullmann thought any move would hold the draw here. But now we will see Geller will improve his position more and more, and his pieces, which already stands very good, will get better and better. Knight e1 and now g5. And we can see the king has now a nice route into the center. In the endgame, as we all know, the king should play a big role, and already we can see the benefits of these pawns moving forward. Later this pawn will blockade the king side and take more space, and will also very useful later, we will see, when the rook comes in. Okay, rook c2, he doesn't want to exchange, and now king e2, the knight was pinned, and as planned, the king comes in, the black king, and now we have a kind of Zugzwang position. Here, white doesn't have good moves, any moves that makes big sense. That's why he had to move the knight. But this will allow the following moves: king f5 and g4. And now we see after bishop d4, total Zugzwang, and he has to move the knight again, and then the rook comes into g1, and this pawn will fall. Knight b3, the bishop doesn't want to exchange, and now the g2 pawn falls. It looks like the rook is boxed in and has problems, but Geller calculated it all very well. The mentioned benefit of the h and g pawn who moved forward is now also visible here. He can move his rook to h3 and then break with h4, and the rook comes out again, no problem. King g2 takes takes, and we can see the king is superior in the center now. The black king is better, the bishop and the rook. F pawn is threatened, no problem. F6, the bishop defends it, and now after rook a2 and rook h8, which activates the rook, and he will come into full play. Ullmann resigned already. He saw black is a pawn up. He has now again an active rook together with the bishop, which is always, almost always, a better tandem than the knight and the rook. And of course, this super active king are too many advantages, and he resigned. He was right to resign and not to play on. Very convincing and very dynamical and positional victory for Yefim Geller, the super grandmaster from Ukraine, or the Soviet Union at this time in 1970. This was a very nice win in the Palma de Mallorca tournament over the German grandmaster Wolfgang Ullmann. And I can recommend you to play this game through again and again. It's very, very instructive. You can learn a lot from it and also from many other games of Geller. And you will see how to sacrifice pawns for initiative, open files, or other positional gains. You will see how convert your advantage after accumulating advantages in the endgame. And all these things, all these very sound and good moves are very helpful for your chess career. Okay, guys, I hope you liked this game between Ullmann and Geller. I also learned a lot from it myself, and I think I will present more and more Soviet chess games in the next videos, and I hope you will be back in the next games and videos. If you want, you can subscribe to my channel, leave me a like, and we see us, if you want, in the next videos. Until then, bye bye.